Hello and welcome to Woman Up, the podcast series by Desperate Artwives. Woman Up is a podcast talking to women artists, creatives, art critics, feminist historians, activists and more. The series was conceived by Desperate Artwives founder Amy Dignam in collaboration with me, Susan Merrick. Desperate Artwives is a platform established in 2010 for women artists who are also mothers and carers. Amy's work focuses on domestic disorder, unsteady identity, power and dysfunction. And I'm an artist interested in feminism, language, power and access. In this platform, we share conversations with women that inspire us and our work, whilst producing a long-form content of resources for other people to access.
Today I'm speaking with Megan Wynne. Megan is a conceptual artist based in Chesapeake, Virginia, who investigates maternal mental health, ambivalence, the shifting power dynamic of the mother-child relationship, and prevailing notions of what embodies a good mother, using her body as a site to explore the innate interdependence and vulnerability of mother and child. Her process involves the act of relinquishing control in experimental, collaborative, performative scenarios with her three children. Wynne has exhibited internationally and widely, including with Desperate Artwives. Her work has also been in multiple publications, including Elephant Magazine and the British Journal of Photography. She holds a BFA in sculpture and an MFA in new genres. Megan, hi, welcome to the podcast.
Thank you for having me.
You're very welcome. I love your bio, I was just saying before we started recording. And one part of it you talk about, which I might not have read out actually, but your whole body in your work almost becomes a piece of sculpture, but also a site for performance. It becomes performative, it becomes a drawing and a drawing landscape. Has your work always crossed boundaries in that way, or is that something that happened once you became a mother?
Well, yes and no, because I actually started out as a dancer. That's what my training was growing up. My birth mother is actually an artist. She went to get her doctorate at the University of Edinburgh, actually. It's Edinburgh, right? It's Edinburgh, right. Isn't it?
Yeah.
Sorry, we have an Edinburgh here. Edinburgh, it's spelled the same, whatever. in art history. But she, I like drawing a little bit. I was not super into art, and I just was really into dance and performing. So it's really natural for me to kind of blur those lines with performative art and mark making, because I my training in adulthood in college and my master's program was more making objects or drawings or things like that. So before I had kids, and like for example in my thesis work, I did a lot of painting on photography, but my photographs were of my work was about relationships then too. I used my body and my, when my husband wasn't my husband, he was my boyfriend. I used him too. There's a lot of like crossover there of mediums and using the body as a site. I would say yes to your question, to be concise.
No, don't worry about talking more. I love it. I can see, so you did sculpture. I can see that a lot in your work. The other thing that's in your work most of the time is either the presence of your children or the, I suppose, the leftovers of these collaborations with your children. Mm-hmm. I kind of looked at them maybe as co-creators. Is that how you see them, or how do you see them within your work?
I see them as... I see them as part of the art making process. It's tricky because in art, like authorship is such a tricky concept. And, you know, you talk about consent and being a child and not being able to, give consent as a child. And we work collaboratively, but I do not consider them in a collaboration. It's confusing. Maybe it's just like semantics, but they are working with me as their mom, like they do every day. And no matter what we do together, they do things because I say, let's do this, or do you want to do this? But they can't fully, I don't think they can fully have authorship. And this was done by Megan Wynne and these people's names that are children. Do you know what I'm saying? I just don't think that's fair to them. So I say, I call it my work, and it's clear that I'm ultimately in control of the work. And I don't want to make it pretend like it's this cutesy idea that we're all equal here, because we're not. I'm their mom. Although they have agency, definitely. And that's something that's incredibly important to me as a mother. I mean, like protecting them and making sure that people respect them and they're respected in every situation. But and my work is really important. So it is a kind of tricky, it's a tricky dance with like wording that and conceptualizing of how we work together. But they definitely have a lot of control in the making of my work.
I was going to ask about that. So when the work comes up, do you, is it a mixture? Do you plan some work and then some spontaneous, or is it always something that you kind of structure, this is what we're going to do? How does it come about?
Well, I think that if I planned out everything, number one, it wouldn't be interesting. Number two, the kids would be annoyed. They wouldn't want to make art with me. And I think you'd be able to tell. Those are my feelings about if I did it any other way. So what I do is I say, because I know my kids, and I say, what would they love to do? What would they find interesting and intriguing and funny and wacky and playful? Which is like what, I mean, to me, that's the best art making process for anyone. And so it doesn't even matter how serious the work is. If there's no plan, I feel like, I don't know, there's something dead in it. I just want, you know, the life in the work, I think, is your ability to have a level of playfulness and experimentation in it. You know, even if you have a plan, which I do with the kids, I have a plan. It's a loose plan, but I have like a framework, and I have an idea of what it's going to look like if I play my cards right. You know, if I can encourage them in the right way and give them just enough of a kind of foundation for them to do their own thing and just naturally do what they want to do and see things where they want to go. But they, you know, kids are just brilliant artists. The thing is that they're so inventive because they don't have narrow ideas of what art is and isn't, and what's acceptable and what isn't acceptable, and how they behave. They act totally inappropriately, and it's delightful, you know, like the way they act, like in general in life, like kids are amazing. They're ridiculous. So, yeah, I have a plan. It's loose, and then I let them go. So for example, in my piece, Motivation, where I had my kids put my two daughters before I had my third child put reward stickers all over my face. I just had a vision. I'm like, that's going to look weird. It's like a mask. And I like making stuff, that deals with, identity, covering up identity, masking identity, about domination, you know, like kind of, who is dominant, who is submissive in a relationship, who is in control and letting go of control, and when to let go and selectively let go. That was interesting to me. And that masking was something that brought up in my mind. So I had a vision. I'm like, okay, my face covered in those really colorful reward sticker stickers. So I was like, do you guys want to cover my face in stickers? And I just laid down on the carpet and put some lights up and just gave them a bunch of stickers. And I just said, cover my whole face. And then, so that was, I mean, it's like, I pretty much made the whole, but I didn't know exactly what they started going down my neck. They were talking, you know what I mean? There's all these variables that I'm not going to, you know, and if they don't enjoy it, I don't do it. Or I'm like, I'm not going to keep doing this. Cause I, you know, I want us to have a good relationship in real life and in my artwork. I want them to continue making work with me. So it's always a dance of, you know, just like in life as a mother, like when do you control your kids, and when do you try to let go of control, and can you handle it? You know, and what's going to happen? So that's kind of the dance of my work.
I think what I always love, so being a parent myself, I always really love having these conversations with other parent artists and other mother artists, because we all have kind of similar, even if our practices are really different or our, how we work, where we work is really different, there's always kind of familiar themes running through, or it seems to be. So you talk about, you know, when to let go and when to have that control with them within your own practice. And I don't make work generally with my kids, although they help me a lot in the background. And they've both got quite a lot of exhibition experience now. But they, the usefulness sometimes of having children around or having, having to work in a flexible way because you're a parent, it can feel really restrictive at times, but other times it can feel really beneficial. Like, you know, we've both said today that we're under the weather a bit, we're not very well. And actually when our practice is maybe at home or is flexible because of the children, sometimes that can be a benefit because we can say, do you know what, today we're just not, we're not doing today. We're going to crash and we're going to do something else and we're going to chill. I mean, then there are other times when actually this is the only period of time we had to do this. So we're just going to have to get on with it and see what comes out of it. But I think it makes us work in different ways.
I agree. And it's ironic. It's like the one thing, it's like, I'm always like, oh, if I didn't have the kids around, I could make art about nothing. You know, like I make art about my kids. Like, it's like this such an, it's like rock and hard place sometimes feeling of like, and it's, you know, it's so weird. I've thought about this so much, but I think that like, I've always had a lot of anxiety. I'm just like a super anxious person. And with my kids, it's like, ironically, they give me so much anxiety. Like it's, you know, I mean, that's this universal thing. Like your heart walking outside of your body. Like those are your kids. Great. Like, great. Now I have three hearts walking outside of my body. Every day is painful and worrisome. And I just, you know, but it allows me to get outside of myself. And I think that it's just so weird. It made me so much more of a mature artist to have kids and have somebody else to pay attention to other than my own damn self all the time and worrying about myself. Like an example of this, which is a ridiculous but good example, is when I was pregnant with my third kid, I was so stressed out. I had two kids already. I was 40. My husband was commuting 2 hours away to go teach at he was an adjunct professor at an art school nearby. And well, not that nearby. And I was so stressed out one day and I looked down. I was like super pregnant. I looked down, my wedding ring and my engagement ring were gone. And I had no memory of losing them or what I did with them. And not only was I dev, and it was handmade, like my engagement ring or my wedding band was handmade by my husband's uncle. Like it was engraved with our, you know, so it was engraved by him, like decoratively engraved and engraved with our names. And it was I was so devastated. One, because I lost my wedding ring and my, you know, obviously, by the way, it's like, am I losing it? What did I do with my rings? I had no memory at all of what I did. And I was freaking out. I was alone. My husband was at work. And I told my kids, because I was watching them and I was upset. And they were like, oh no, I'm so sorry, Mom. I'm so sorry. And then they went back to playing and they really didn't care that much because they don't care. And I'm like, you know what? If they're okay and they don't care, I'm okay. It's not a big deal. And I got over it. I got over it because my kids didn't care that much, you know, and it made me realize like what really is important. And in my work, although my kids give me so much anxiety about like relying on them and like I needing their help to make the work interesting, at the same time, if they don't, it's like giving away some of my responsibility too, as someone to make, because I feel so much pressure. I'm such a perfectionist. Now that's part of my anxiety, I think, is like wanting to make genius artwork. You know, that's what it's like. Yeah, that's your job. You went to, I mean, and I paid for art school that I couldn't afford. So it was like, you know, okay, you know, and then it's like, well, then giving them some power and some creative control is like, oh, that feels good. It's not all on me. You know, I don't think a lot of people are the way I am because a lot of people don't do the kind of work I make, but somehow it actually helps my anxiety and helps me as a person. But it is like really, I just taught this word to my kids. It starts with an S. It's like, no, it's not an S. It's, where something is like, it seems like the opposite would be true, but it's true. A paradox. It's a paradox.
Yeah. I think I can, well, I very clearly can see that in your work and see this dichotomy as well of almost the violence of motherhood at times.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And then the extreme care and hilarity that comes along with it. Like, forgive me for not remembering titles, but the image.
Oh, I don't even remember the title.
But the image of engorgement, the piece with the engorged breasts and, you know, the breast pad sticking, mm-hmm. breast pad sticking just slightly above the maternity bra and, almost bruising and blue veined breasts. And just, when you're thinking about the experience of breastfeeding or engorgement of breasts, whether you breastfed or not, and for those who've experienced it, it just brings back lots of memories of this violent change in your body, and then what's done to your body, and how you use your body, and your children use your body. But then there are these hilarious moments, like people noticing or you noticing that you've got, you know, a breast pad might have come up past your top, and right. you know, other people are like, what's that? It's like, oh, or, you know, leaking breasts, or, you know, these times when having children is humiliating or embarrassing or whatever else, but then also just funny and real life, and it's actually okay that these things happen. And I think children give us that, don't they?
Yeah. And it's this kind of unbridled vulnerability and dependency on display. It's like you have a kid and maybe, you know, they're going to pull their, you know, like you have a 3-year-old and they're going to pull down their pants in public, and then you have to go pull their pants back up for them, you know, whatever. It's like they don't have that notion of propriety. So you have to roll with it. And it's like there's something so freeing. And it also, you know, along with breastfeeding, it kind of, you know, you think about the stupid taboos around breastfeeding and breastfeeding in public, and how it's like, and, you know, this idea that you're supposed to be ashamed and it's inappropriate. And it's like, what the hell? Like, it's all interrelated. It's like, all of us mothers are going through the same thing. Like, why are we hiding? It's beautiful. It's intimate. It's funny. It's tender. And it's about it's about love. And it's just what it is what it is, but it's not something that, you know, should be hidden. It's just an expression of like love. And it's interesting because in my work, just as an artist, as a person, I think about love a lot, what that means, and what, I don't even know what it means, which is, you know, might be weird, but because it's so much about like need and dependence, and where does that end, and where does selfishness end and selflessness begin? And I really don't really know. But I think in my work and in my life, I'm just doing my best.
I think I have a couple of questions related to this first. So I wanted to ask how were this parent-child relationships of yours kind of formed and conditioned, do you think? Is it because you were an artist that kind of formed your relationship, or the life experiences you as a woman, is that more about how you have your relationship with your children? Which has more influence for you in terms of your relationship?
I think it's a bit of both, but I was adopted. I was adopted at birth. I really wasn't actually ever adopted. I found out when I was 18 that they never adopted me. They just took me out of the hospital, but it was consensual. Okay. That was kind of weird to find out. I was like finding out I was adopted all over again. But, I've always had kind of a complicated relationship with motherhood, as a result of all of that in my life, just personally, like being mothered and being not mothered, and so I think it really caused me to look at motherhood through a different lens, like, you know, from the outside. I was really hyper aware of it, you know, as a role that I didn't really understand, you know, like I mean, lots of women, people aren't breastfed, but I wasn't breastfed. I'd never seen breastfeeding. Lots of people are like me in that way, you know, not just because I was adopted or anything, but, you know, having my own child, being pregnant after being, you know, living through it and being like, wow, like, you know, my mother couldn't, you know, she just couldn't keep me or whatever, but it's just like being like, wow, I'm choosing to keep my children and I'm pregnant by choice. And it's like unbelievable. It's just like unbelievable. It's like earth shattering. So really like living it. And then while I'm living it, comparing it to being, and actually trying to put myself in the shoes of my parent, my birth mother and my adopted mother, and seeing myself in them. It's just really strange. And it's something that I'm hyper, that kind of the role of motherhood, I have a hyper awareness of, kind of like trying to step back from it and trying to see it objectively and just try to pick it apart and understand it. It's something that I've always had since I was a kid. I think I remember the first time I was going to meet my birth mother. I was like, oh, so I'm going to call her mom too. Okay. Like I was talking to my adoptive mother. And I just had this plan. Like I thought she was going to be like my mom too, as well. Yeah. I was like six. I don't know. And she came in, she's actually my aunt by blood. I mean, no, she's literally my mother, birth mother, but she's in the family. I was adopted in the family. So it was like, she was functioning as an aunt. So she came now, she was just like, hi. And then she walked past and I was like, oh, this is not how it's going to be. It was just strange. Yeah. So yeah, a lot of my interactions like that, just in general around motherhood have been, I think, probably a little unique and affected my work a lot. And also as an artist, I'm like, I look at childhood differently. I look at the art of children differently, I think, than I would otherwise. But that's harder for me to parse out, I think, than my perspective on motherhood. Because it's something I think about so much. Like intentionally, I kind of like research it in my, like I study it in myself, I guess, a lot. Intentionally, I write about it, stuff like that. Yeah.
It's almost turning the lens on yourself, isn't it?
Yeah.
In a metaphorical way, as well as the actual camera lens. I think sometimes we can't, in our work as artists, it doesn't always make sense to avoid the things that are framing our life and framing our work. I've always come back to working with feminism and working with women's hidden voices, and usually domestic violence and women who've had to escape. And it's totally because that's what happened to my mum and my grandma and that family. You know, my mum was given away when she was a baby in a pub by her dad. She was found again and came back, and then the story kind of changed over time, and eventually, you know, people talked about it as that she was fostered out, or that because it was during the Second World War, it was like evacuee, but it wasn't. It was
right.
It was just him gambling in the pub.
People try to. I have experienced like people trying to retell my story to me, and trying to make it feel good to them. Mm-hmm. Do you know what I'm saying? And it's like, you just shut up.
Yeah,
you don't know what you're talking about.
Well, I think so. I wonder if I'll do it because I'm sure my mum has, you know, told the story in different ways, maybe depending on my age and depending on how she's feeling at the time about it. And also she doesn't have anyone to ask and kind of get that information. Her family have all passed away. So she is quite lonely, I think, in that story. So I'm glad that we share it, but it's definitely impacted on the direction of my work. I wanted to ask how is your work received? So you've exhibited widely. You're in publications. You have a great presence with your work. How is it received within mainstream art world? So not the non-maternal art world and field. Yeah.
I don't know. I feel like I have a lot of feelings. For one thing, I feel like because I'm so busy and because I'm a mom and because I have anxiety and I talk about it in my work, I have trouble, like when you apply to stuff, they're always like, you need to have work that's 3 years old or 2 years old or newer, or else we don't want to see it. And that really hurts my career because I can't make work like that. Mm-hmm. I have huge periods of time where I cannot make work, and it's due to my mental health and just my life having children, which I wouldn't give away for, you know, I mean, I wouldn't trade, you know, but I think that's kind of, that's something that's kind of a main, like a kind of a art world ism that's really cruel and unfair to, it's like, oh, we want new things that no one's ever seen before or something like that. But like my work is a continuum and it functions all together as a whole. And I think that as a side effect of the work I make, the maternal artwork I make, a lot of mother artists are very, they are able, and they often have older kids too, but, or less children make work, a lot of work, you know, really fast. And they're always able, but it's like, I don't work that way. So I don't really apply to stuff very often because of like, for fear, I just don't, you know, that's not, they want work that's all like brand new and they want like a bunch of images of brand new work. That's just like a little technical thing that I find to be shitty for me. But let me think. I don't know. I feel like my work doesn't really fall easily into one genre. And I think like that can be problematic for me because I'm not really a photographer and I'm not really a performance artist. And I think that my work can kind of slip through the cracks in that way. And people don't really know how to frame it and place it. Also, in another sense, my work gets stolen a lot on Instagram because it's easily memeable. It's like quick, you can get a quick read from it and get the joke, but not really read into it any deeper. And my work gets treated like garbage a lot. It gets rememed offensively. It's been used by Frida Baby on their, you know, like companies, you know, without asking me. An Argentinian gynecologist has it up on her Instagram with like 80,000 likes. It's like a city worth of likes or something. And I hadn't been able to get her to take it down. But so my work, it's weird. So it's like accepted by pop culture in a way, it seems like, in a way that I don't really feel comfortable with. That's why I made my Instagram private. And it's been really offensively memed. One time, it's been double memed. So like one time there was a meme where he took this person, I call him a he, I'm just going to do it. Someone took my art and it was an image of me and my two daughters and one is breastfeeding and they had drawn all over my face. It was from Mask of Motherhood. It was 2016. And they took that image. I don't know where they got it. I mean, I have a website. I don't know where they got it, but it was a bad quality image. They cropped it weird. And then put a Durex condom symbol in the corner. It's like a fake Durex condom ad about not having children. Like how you wouldn't want to have kids, wear condoms. And yeah. And and that was on the front page of Reddit. And it had like 20,000, I didn't even use Reddit. A bunch of people I knew just kept like out of the blue, like people I hadn't talked to in 10 years were messaging me like, look. And then that meme a few years later, so I got it taken down eventually, although I had to fight for it. And then a couple years later, that meme got re-memed by somebody. I mean, that's how deep it goes, like how deep and dark the world of what's going on. Where someone said that time you realized maybe anal was a good idea. That was the text on the image, on my image.
Oh my God.
Yeah. And then they had watermarked it with their own like weird, Grim Reaper symbol. I didn't even know what it was. I was like, what is that thing on my pillow? It's like on my couch. I'm like, is that part of the picture? I don't remember that. I look up close and I had to zoom in. I'm like, oh, that's a Grim Reaper symbol someone put on my piece. To watermark it for themselves without like a, I don't even know.
Playing so that, it, yeah.
It's just, that's been a whole So I my work exists in a weird netherland, neverland. I don't even know. I try not to think about it too hard. I try not to focus on my career too hard because you know, I'm making work about my kids and my life, and it's incredibly personal. And yeah. I'm exposing myself to such an extent, and I'm so vulnerable. And I don't think, and you know, because I believe in art so much, I believe in it so much, I feel compelled to do it. And I know I'm doing the right thing. But then to focus on all that stuff, it's just bullshit to me. I'm not trying to be like I'm a cool person or something. But it's uncomfortable, you know, and it's also, it's probably to do with my anxiety. But then, you know, I put my work on Instagram, and then that kind of stuff happens. And, you know, I just try to make the work and have integrity, yeah. You know.
I had a conversation with artist Nicola Hunter, a podcast interview, mm-hmm. only a couple of months ago, and some really, really similar themes with regards to her work and vulnerability and anxiety, and also stolen work and how it was used. And it's just making me wonder, I wonder how often this happens to artists in general, but is there a different way that women who are making work regarding maternal and regarding their body, is that taken and used in a different way? Because yeah, I'm curious now. I have to see if it's happening to other people and whether there is a discriminatory or an overly violent kind of way of being used.
It's interesting. I recently was, you know, since my Instagram became private, I you know, I have to accept follower requests, and it's like, who do I don't know these people, you know, it's like ridiculous. Like, what am I, you know, it just feels like there's no real solution. But there is one, you know, breastfeeding art, you know, breastfeeding art is actually an IG that I've worked with, and, you know, I know her. And, but there's other breastfeeding, or like pregnancy art, and it's just purely fetish. Like, it's clearly fetish. And I think that, I mean, fetish is one thing when it's consensual or whatever, but I think these women are sharing these images, not really realizing what they're being a part of. You know, they think it's for other moms to commiserate or whatever, but it's, you know, when you really look into the page, it's like clearly a fetish page. Yeah. If you really look hard enough,
yeah,
you know, it's just sad, because I do feel like, you know, visibility is so important. And then it's like, how do you avoid, you know, it's not my job. It's like, you know, it's not the victim's job to police.
Yeah. And especially when women artists still are lacking in representation in more traditional art spaces. And then artists who are mothers, especially who are making work about mothers, are kind of even more narrowly categorized and invisible. You know, social media is a way that these artists have to get the work out and to talk about the work and to talk with each other about the work. So you don't want to be limiting that visibility. But yeah, it's a really difficult divide, isn't it?
Yeah, you feel like you're making the work because you feel like it needs to be seen, not to, you know, I don't make the work to keep it in my house. I make work to share in and connect with people and share an experience with them and feel less alone. I mean, that's why I make art, you know. And then it's like, or to have a dialogue and say, why don't we talk about this kind of stuff? Like, why aren't we, you know? Yeah. So, and then it's like, I don't know. It just doesn't seem like the
risk.
Format. Yeah. The formats aren't really made for us, you know? And I was talking to a pro bono arts lawyer, and, you know, I told him, I was like, you know, I kind of feel like this is the Wild West, you know? And he's like, you're pretty much right. You're pretty much right. It kind of is, you know. I'm like, great. And then he's like rich art, you know, rich people, rich artists, or I don't know. They have, you know, lawyers out there constantly looking out for infringement cases, and they're ready to go to bat and get litigious and all this stuff. And it's like, but for you, you know, it's just kind of like, you're shit out of luck. Like, you're just a person, you know, that's not, that can't afford, you know, it's just like, I don't know. It's really disheartening. Yeah. I still believe in my work and showing it and everything, but it's like everything that's depressing. I feel like I, you know, sometimes my anxiety like gives me an unhealthy view of things that it's unrealistic. And I'm afraid my view of this kind of stuff is super objective. Yeah. It's super realistic. So but
I think the work that you do is so vital and so important. And it's, you know, it is a way it's a way that artists can really explore a different way of working, that can think about their body and sculpture and performance and photography in a different way, in an accessible way, but also an accessible way that really conveys very complex messages. Mm-hmm. And likewise, it also gives those other artists and women who are maybe feeling similar anxieties to you about parenthood, you know, it's something to cling on to as well, because it's this shared experience. Mm. And so really important. So yeah, please continue.
I don't think I can start for
the last thing I wanted to ask about is in the bio that you sent me, you talked about just wrapping up a collaborative documentary project. Please could you tell us about that, Megan?
Sure. I was contacted by a producer at my local PBS affiliate, I guess it's called. It's WHRO. It's a public broadcasting network in the U.S. And they do segments on, like, brief segments on artists. And because of COVID, it was a big problem. They were like, oh, we would usually come over, stay all day. And it's like, I'm like, I make work in my house with my kids. And we had this bit, we had like lots of discussions about it. And it was like, we really want to do this, but we need to do it now. And so it ended up, I agreed, you know, it's kind of perfect. I'm perfect for this moment because I have experience as a photographer. I document my family, give me your equipment and I'll do it myself. So that's what I did. They literally dropped off thousands of dollars worth of equipment at my front door, sanitized. And I took it in and I tried to figure it out as best I could, but I'm not a super technical. I mean, I learn a technique to an end. I'm not just like a nerd about it. I'm just like, this is annoying. You know, buttons are annoying. Equipment's annoying. So there's like, I mean, nerds, I love nerds, but I'm just not one of them. And so they gave me a GoPro and these different mounts and a gimbal. I didn't know what that was. And they gave me a better DSLR than I have, a full frame DSLR. And I shot for like 2 months. And you know, because I have a lot, my husband works full time. I have, you know, like my kids have, I'm homeschooling all three of my dang children. And one of them is three and he does not want me to do anything other than play with him. So me teaching the girls is almost, I mean, like my life is so, you know, of course with everyone's having a challenging time, but then having to shoot a documentary about myself and make art, it was really challenging. Yeah, it was, and learn a totally new skills, right? I had to be a videographer, a director.
See, I think maybe you are not. I think it's okay if we become nerds, because being an artist and having to rely on technology even prior to COVID, I think brings out the nerd in us, and because we have to just get it. And I'm loving it.
I had a blast, but I had a lot of technical issues and I'm just like, I'm not into the image stabilization on the DSLR doesn't have to be on when it's mounted and it messes up the audio, like that stuff. I'm just I don't want to know this and I don't care and I wish it wouldn't do this to me. So, I mean, now I know a lot more. I learned, it was like a crash course in, you know, being all those things I'd never done before. Of course I'm a, you know, it's like, to some extent I'm a director of my own art. You know, I tell my, you know, like I say, I'm going to be here. I'm going to stand here. I'm going to do this, but I don't shoot lots of video documentary style of myself. I mean, it's hard to be the director and the subject. It was hard, but it was super fulfilling and I'm really proud of it. And I saw a rough cut of it and I'm so excited. And the head producer at WHRO said it gave him the chills. So I don't want to build it up. I should not have said that.
Well, so when this podcast airs in a few weeks, the premiere will have already been out. So how can people see it once it's premiered?
I think, WHRO has a website. It's through a program called Curate 757. So 757 is our area code. So it's local, but it's several cities in the area. And it's called Hampton Roads is the area in Virginia where I am. I live in a city called Chesapeake, but, and there's a website there, Curate 757. I think it's through them. It's like probably whro.org, probably /curate757 or something like that. But if you Google those words, I'm sure it'll come up. I think, I hope.
Great.
I'll find out this Thursday and Friday when I actually see the final thing. I have to link my parents and everything to it.
Yeah. Amazing. We'll look out for that.
Thank you.
This has been brilliant. Thank you very much, Megan.
Oh, thank you so much. It was an honor.
Yeah, it's amazing. I'm just seeing if there's anything else I wanted to ask you. Is there anything else you wanted to talk about?
I can't think of anything else. I kind of, you know, for my, you know, sometimes I get so like for my own mental health, I decided to just approach this today, like totally, you know, casually and truthfully, you know what I mean? And just totally be totally open and stuff. Because I think sometimes when I worry too much about like covering all my data points and everything, it's too much and it doesn't necessarily help anything, help the quality of the final outcome. So I'm totally like an open book, but I'm just here. I feel like I'm here for what you want to talk about. I'm just kind of open.
Yeah, no, it's been really, really lovely. Really lovely to have your time, Megan.
I feel like everyone, when I listened to the artist podcast, I was like, I am, you know, these women, like I'm reading, you know, I'm listening to them and stuff, and they're often like, so like hardcore, like politically engaged and like changing the thing. And I'm just like, just doing my thing.
You're doing more than just your thing, believe me.
But I hope there's a place for me. Like, you know, Amy wanted me to do it. So, but anyway, I appreciate it. Thank you so much.
No, it's fantastic. I think your work's amazing. So I'm really glad that we're going to be able to share it again. Really pleased.
Thank you for listening. This is Woman Up, the podcast series by Desperate Artwives.